Hem començat amb una pel·lícula i bé, comencem la jornada de la tarda i us presento en primer lloc el Ferran Miquel, que és guionista i director tècnic del documental L'altra normalitat, cofundador de la cooperativa Grupdem, és llicenciat en Filosofia i Ciències de l'Educació, amb especialitat en Pedagogia Terapèutica. És funcionari del cos de professorat de l'ensenyament secundari de la Generalitat de Catalunya i és doctor en mètodes de recerca avaluativa i qualitativa. És coordinador de projectes artístics a l'associació Pasparto, envoltat per mig món, i actualment és també consultor independent. Es vol jubilar però no el deixem. Com va anar això, Ferran, aquesta pel·lícula?
Bé, bona tarda. Doncs primer, com sempre, agrair la possibilitat de participar en aquesta trobada i de poder presentar aquesta pel·lícula de fa 43 anys, no? Ha passat molt de temps. Cal dir que aquesta, jo, els meus orígens, diguem-li, estudiós de, o estudiant de pedagogia a la facultat i un col·lectiu de nois i noies que treballaven una mica hipiosos, una associació de pares ens va contractar perquè féssim de monitors en una escola taller que havíem muntat i que els havia cedit l'Ajuntament. Allí comença el meu coneixement en el món de l'educació especial. Aquest coneixement s'allargarà fins l'any 1980, més o menys uns 20-25 anys, en els que vaig deixar l'educació especial per dedicar-me a un altre tema vinculat també amb les relacions humanes, amb la relació social, però no hi ha amb educació especial, entenguent que era un camp que per mi estava no superat però que em veia impossibilitat, diguem-li, de seguir-hi treballant amb ell. No necessitava objectivar. Aquesta pel·lícula la vàrem fer a l'any 80 i aquesta pel·lícula ja era el final de la meva etapa en el centre que en aquell vam muntar feia 15 anys. L'origen deia que una associació als anys 60 i pico hi va haver-hi els moviments socials de les associacions de pares que davant de la inactivitat i davant de la deixadesa des d'un punt de vista, diguem-li, administratiu, es van animar, sobretot, almenys aquí a Catalunya, van ser pares de classe mitjana, amb un estat de benestar en molts casos elevat, els que van promoure la solució, diguem-li, de què fer amb els seus fills des de que naixien, el cas dels rebentors, del Cava, que va tenir una nena mongòlica, igual, síndrome de Down, i que a mesura que es va anar fent gran, doncs hi va fent una guarderia, una escola, fins al final la residència. Vull dir, hi havia un poder adquisitiu i un moviment, doncs, diguem-li, de classe mitjana, que es va atrevir a tirar endavant aquests projectes. Una d'elles, doncs, l'Ajuntament els hi va cedir uns locals i va muntar una escola taller. Aquests estudiants hipiosos i de psicopedagogia, doncs diguem així, ens van contractar i vam anar a treballar allà perquè d'alguna manera havíem de sobreviure, havíem fet voluntariat, però cobràvem el primer mini sou. La feina que ens van donar era, doncs, al matí havíem de treballar l'escola, llegir, escriure, matemàtiques, vull dir, tots els temes, diguem-li, educatius escolars. Després dedicàvem un temps a manipulacions, manipulats. Una empresa d'elèctric, fent una obra social, diguem-ho així, va donar material per desbarbar. I els nanos, doncs, era una feina molt rutinària, molt simple, i que ens passaven algunes hores fent aquestes feines que d'alguna manera, doncs, servien per anar entrenant o entrant en aquest món del treball. Després dinàvem, perquè estaven tot el dia, i després de dinar fèiem activitats lúdiques, socials, activitats esportives, culturals. Vull dir, una mica intentàvem, és la feina que ens van assignar, hi havia un director i els pares ens van assignar que la nostra funció era aquesta, estar amb els nanos i per tant estàvem tot el dia. Els pares, evidentment cal valorar-los, aquells pares els calia valorar la iniciativa, no? Vull dir, que davant de la indiferència de l'administració ells prenen aquesta iniciativa. I aquesta iniciativa doncs, els envolentona, creen una associació i aquesta associació creuen ells convençuts de que són l'únic que poden aportar solucions. La solució, doncs, el que fan és el que entenen que s'ha de fer, que per treballar necessiten l'escola, bé, utípic i utòpic. Almenys estem parlant dels anys 70. En aquests moments, aquests pares, doncs, contents de muntar això, i ens donen a fer aquesta feina. Nosaltres, que no coneixíem pràcticament el que era el món de la deficiència mental, o dels subnormals que se'n deia abans, no el coneixíem gens, però anàvem una mica de col·leguilles, vull dir, érem una mica irreverents de cara als pares, perquè amb aquells nanos els vèiem, des de la nostra perspectiva, els vèiem com a normals, ho eren. En la seva deficiència, en el seu món, eren tan normals
com a normals. We see them as normal people.
El que ens manaven que féssim amb ells, ens adonàvem compte que no teníem.
We thought that where they told us to do with them had no sense. We did it because they told us that we had to do it, but for us it was just to spend time with them, but not equipping them to be part of the society later on. The goal for us was to take them out of the house because for many reasons, and you've seen in the documentary, we had to include the causes. Many families had a bad conscience for religious, moral. It was very complicated. And they, the families felt guilty, and for the families to take them somewhere so the children were not in the street, that gave the family some peace. So they took them to the school. And for us, that probably we had a different idea, we were studying, and in little time, we didn't see these people with disabilities as people we had to protect. We found out very quickly that when these children were exposed to different situations, when we were in the street, for instance, these children reacted in a different way. They didn't do what they told them to do, but they did other things to know themselves better. And we talked to the principal and asked him to change the system, the methodology we were using, because we were not helping these children. And we want these children to find out how they were. We wanted to respect these children and live with them, because we didn't know them. And despite all the science, people had put, or society had put, a label on them. We proposed something to stop doing what we were doing, and what we said is, if you have a problem, it's the society. There was a rejection coming from society. And we talked to the parents and said, we want these children to walk in the street, to be confronted to conflicts, see how they manage the conflicts when they are in the street or problems. And the parents and the director, well, they didn't agree with us. They thought that was nonsense, that these children had to be protected and the society would harm them. And then a dynamics started, and we were opposing this dynamic. We told the principal of the center and the parents that we could not accept that. We were proposing to carry out a series of activities, and the parents didn't want. And we told the parents, well, you're the parents, but that doesn't give you the capacity of knowing what your children need. It's very good that you take your children somewhere, but you have to face the reality. And parents were very scared. And up to a certain point, it was true, because many of these children had been marginalized, not treated well. And when they were in the street, other people looked at them, and parents didn't feel well. And we told the parents that these children had to interact, but parents said no. And something also that happened with the parents. Parents had the concept that they want to impose on how to educate their children. And it's not that we opposed to that, but we were quite critical. And the last straw was that the parents that belong to the middle class, they went to the radio shows, TVs, newspapers, and they wanted to tell the association how to work, because an association was created and legalized, so this association could work with these children with disabilities. But the parents realized that the government was giving also little money for the association, but parents realized that they needed the association to continue existing and working. So they decided, the parents, to launch campaigns in newspapers, radio shows, TV, and some people would, for instance, work with them, giving them things or money. But in the images we have seen in the documentary, there were children with different disabilities, children crying, images that Llorenç Soler, who was the director of photography, tried to portray these children as poor children, little things that were only worth of compassion. And this, the image they were portraying of this, yeah, they could attract money with this, but for us it was peanuts, and giving this image did not help the children. However, the parents said that this would help them, and more children could come to the association, and they could have more money and build a residence for these children. But we were opposed. We said, well, first we have to get to know these children with disabilities. We have to know who they really are, and they have to know themselves too. And we were, in a way, telling the parents that they were being demagogical, and that they were reinforcing or strengthening their children's disabilities. It's true that maybe we were a little bit rude, and in the end, I was fired together with other colleagues because the parents considered we didn't know how to handle the children, or we treated them in a non-adequate way. We went to court, and we were hippies at that time, and the judge said the parents are right. And then we went
Aquestes sis persones, el que van
there were,
va ser, no pot ser això.
It was six of us,
manera,
and
no
we said, we have to show
no
that what we say is right.
Món,
we have opened up to a new world. We want to do things that are new things, and we want these children to be respected, to be accepted as they are, not criticizing them or judging them by moral standards. We had, but we didn't have the mechanism. And then we decided to set up a cooperative, a central for people with a special need, with professionals. And we set up, as I was saying, a cooperative and a special education center. And we opened the centers in the neighborhood of Horta in Barcelona. And all these ideas we have to take the children to the street. Our neighborhood was an industrial neighborhood with little green spaces, but we didn't have a swimming pool, we didn't have a bar, we didn't have anything. But anyway, we liked the area. And the neighborhood was our school. The square was our courtyard. And we didn't have anything. So with the children, we went to have breakfast to a bar. Then we had lunch in a public restaurant. We went to the market. We participated in different initiatives. And we did everything in the neighborhood, and the children integrated in the neighborhood. So we saw that what we had to do is the children to be themselves, so people could get to know them. And that was in Horta, as I was saying, the neighborhood of Horta. But the reality was that through friends and connections we had, we saw that many of those children were misdiagnosed. The last young woman that you've seen in the documentary was one of these cases of a misdiagnosed. So what we wanted, we had 45 children with us, and 40% we could send them to work in a company or with a relative, and we have still contact with many of them, and they are still working. They were not difficult people, but they were in special places. The important thing wasn't the work or the job they were doing. The important thing was the coexistence, living in the neighborhood, in the community. And it was very difficult, but we were satisfied. It wasn't easy. So one of the reasons why the documentary was made was because we didn't like this parents' association, because that association lost control, went from being, I don't know exactly how to describe it, made of the whole thing a personal matter, and you cannot do that. And these parents from this association knew that they started arguing with other parents on who got more money from the government. This idea of getting together was a good initial idea. However, the needs do not always justify that you have to deal with these needs. So we wanted to explain that. And another reason for the documentary, for that we have to go back to the 80s. There was a movement of workshops, schools, that suggested creating an institution that would coordinate all the workshops. We took part in it, and there were two different stances. On the one hand, some people thought that we have to demand the government to subsidize the special education centers and to guarantee the work done by these workers, because usually the workshops depended on the help of the parents. And here some people said, no, these workshops have to be subsidized 100% by the government. And some other people thought, and that was our stance, we consider that the first thing was to so that all companies could hire people with disabilities to close the special needs centers, because the idea was that these people could work in normal companies and depending on their characteristics and needs. And staff had to be trained. It's not enough to be nice and to wear a certain uniform. We thought that the best professionals had to work with this collective, with this group of people with disabilities. So we wanted a series of tutors, of mentors in special education, whose goal was twofold. On the one hand, following up children, young people working in companies to adapt the job position. And secondly, these young people with disabilities working in companies, well, to talk to people working to the rest of the staff. The mentors, the tutors, would create a multidisciplinary team who would work in all the areas or supervise all the areas in which these young people work. Leisure, school, job. So we wanted this project to be a truly collaborative one, because we thought that special education had to be dealt with in a holistic approach and requires collaborative work. And that means that each has to contribute. Each person has to contribute, and by consensus, we make decisions. Núria is here, and I think that you should leave it here, because otherwise we won't have enough time, because there are other people that need to talk. One of the problems of these kind of meetings is that we want to be so scientific that we give a certain amount of time when we should be more flexible. If we are so Cartesian, okay, now I'm going to finish soon, and now I've lost the thread. What did I want to say? Well, conclusion. The documentary reflects these three elements. A criticism towards the parents that make of the whole thing a personal issue, and they treat their children in a contradictory way. And the second thing was, and it was reflected, the professionals, they say, oh, if these young people go and work in a company, they are going to be harmed. Well, no, we have to change the situation so these young people can go there and not be harmed.
In solidarity
cannot be understood as working only on the emergencies and not working on prevention. For the government, it's very useful to work only in emergency situation, but we have to work on prevention. And we are all entangled in this logic. So what we wanted to say is if we have a problem, if we don't understand it well, even if we have the best solution, it's not going to work. So here, deep down was how to manage the problem, how we understand the problem. And we had to do it from a multidisciplinary point of view. And in our conservative and in our society of consumption, well, this is not easy. The labor division is not always useful. It's like, this is my department, but here we have to tackle the issue from a holistic point of view. And I think that probably we're wrong when we want to divide or divide the labor so much. Today I had lunch with you, and that was very enriching. And I've seen how many of the pathologies and or the problems we had many decades ago, we still have them. And we should reflect collectively, I insist, in a collaborative manner. We are all useful, and we should make decisions by consensus. If we were able to do that, it would be fantastic. We can have many initiatives, but if we want to show our solidarity, we have to see what our responsibility is and that the politicians show their solidarity towards society. Our brain has allowed us to create codes that allow us to be professionals and members of the society. The person who pays is not the person who rules or decides. It shouldn't be like that. Doctors have a deontological code. Some doctors are opposed to perform abortions, for instance. Why other citizens couldn't have a deontological code? It was very enriching having lunch with you and talking here. I apologize if I have spoken too much.
Thank you very much, Ferran. It's always a pleasure to listen to you. Well, I'm no expert in the topic, so unfortunately the sound is poor. We'll do our best. Thank you very much, Ferran. Unfortunately, the time is limited. I would like to reiterate my acknowledgement to the organizers, to Oriol, and I'd like to thank also to the speakers this morning, which have been amazing, because they are alerting us about the importance of memorializing. The documentary has been very thought and emotions provoking. Let me go to the end of what I wanted to mention. Have you seen significant changes in the situation compared to 25 years ago? Remember what the English used to say? Not in my backyard, right? Yeah, well, these were the Americans. Yeah, well, of course, I can coexist with others, but not in my backyard, right? So we're speaking about other normalities, other forms of being, non-standard ways of being. So depending on our lenses, we'll see one thing, or another. We've had interesting concepts such as subnormal, mentally retarded, mongolic, mongols. My mother used to call his son a mongolic. So again, the medium is difficult. A rejection, a clear rejection.
Clar, potser la clienta s'enfadarà, o potser es pot fer mal, o potser és un perill.
Or perhaps it's dangerous.
Recordo també que la majoria de persones en aquestes èpoques es deia que el que tenien era anòxia connatal, i és que havia faltat aire al cervell. Era una de les diagnosis més habituals que hi havia, no? També, ostres, també veiem que totes se centren en les limitacions.
We also speak about putting the focus on limitations. Yes, but, you know, there's a highly hypocritical perspective, as the documentary shows. There are dreams, for example, I want to be a civil servant. See, a civil servant, as you mentioned before. I want to be a hairdresser. I want to be a fashion designer. Within families who are suffering a great deal, overprotective families, the permanent child, the never growing child. So of course, the debate is wide, but I think I'm going to leave it for the end.
Ahir va haver-hi un fet en el campionat aquest mundial o europeu de futbol.
Yesterday, in the European Champions League, a French player or a couple of French players gave their point of view, their political stance. They said that it's not acceptable to, let the extreme right wing in France beat the election.
Perquè ell el que feia era treballar futbol i la seva missió és només poder parlar de futbol.
Such contribution.
Per tant, aquí tenim això ahir. Tenim
out of place. He said that his role was speaking about soccer. So this is my territory, so I don't want to get into this trouble, right? So we're not capable of being holistic. The school is not educating for a holistic perspective. The school system is not educating citizens to be citizens, but only for economic purposes. And you suffer this, you are victims of that. Thank you very much, the interpreters. Really apologize. Our job is almost impossible with a